as a God-man, here's what he does. He does seven things. But number one, he reveals God. The Bible calls him the image of the invisible God. He that hath seen me hath seen God. You've heard the story of the little kid drawing his kindergarten picture? Teacher said, what are you drawing? He said, God. Teacher said, nobody knows what God looks like. Kid says, they will now. No, we don't know what God is like, except when you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There he is. The Word became flesh. And he reveals what man is. He was perfectly righteous. He obeyed God just like you and I have to. What should a man be like? Only in Christ can we be told to mimic Christ. Paul said, mimic me as I mimic Christ. He is God's perfect man, man's perfect God. Thirdly, he fulfills the Davidic covenant. God made a promise to King David that from your descendants I will raise up one that will sit on the throne, house, and kingdom of Israel forever. Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of God's promises to David to bless the covenant nation of Israel. God had to send a king, and thus did the angel say, you shall find wrapped in swaddling clothes Christ the Lord. He is the Messiah. Said to Mary, God will give him the throne, the house, and the kingdom of his father David forever and forever. He also serves as mediator. Media, meaning in the middle. Job said in his day, God is not a man that I can come to him. He said, I need an umpire who can lay his hand on us both. Job said, I need an advocate, one who can stand in God's presence and plead my case. Because when you are a sinner, you don't need arguments. You need someone who is a God-man to stand for you. When you're a sinner, you need Jesus Christ the righteous. Someone has to stand in God's presence for you. He is our mediator. 1 Timothy 2:4. There is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Fifthly, as the God-man, he defeats Satan. He is the seed of woman that crushes the serpent's head. He is the one, Paul said, that disarms the rulers and the authorities. The one that Peter said sits at the right hand of God after angels, authorities, and powers had been subjected to him. He's the one that said, I come that Satan might be cast out. He is the one through whom came to destroy the works of the devil and to undo death. He is the one that came to reconcile all creation. The Bible says the creation longs for the appearing of the sons of God, that when Christ comes and his church with him, that the lion will lay down with the lamb, and someday the heavens will pass away with a roar, and God will bring about new heavens and new earth where righteousness dwells by him who subjects all things to himself. And seventhly, he is the last Adam. You see, biblically, the idea is that if you're going to escape death and judgment, you're going to have to get off the boat. This human race is the Titanic, and it's going down. You can be a better sinner than others, but you're still qualitatively a sinner. The only way you can escape is you've got to jump ship and got to be born again of another race that has another representative head. For in Adam, we've all sinned. We are conceived in sin and brought forth in iniquity. Through a new and last Adam, there is a new humanity that are born of him. Philippians 2, 5 through 7, when you get some time, it's the best verse on the incarnation. He existed in the form of God, but he did not regard equality with God a thing to be held on to, but emptied himself and took the form of a bondservant. The incarnation is the laying aside of glory and the independent use to himself of his own deity.